And that's what you need to do with non-believers. Don't be alarmed. Don't get defensive. Learn your stuff. You know, get some arguments. You don't have to, you know, become expert in science and history and philosophy. Gosh, I would say to you, just master an argument for the resurrection of Jesus.
What advice would you give us when we step out of this church and we go back to our homes or our schools or our workplace and we have peers who are experiencing those doubts? What is there, excuse me, what would you say is the most important thing? So if you could summarize from your talk or from your experience, what is the key thing to remember when talking to people who have that have doubts?
Yeah, good question. I'd say love them. Be patient with them. Don't get bent out of shape. You know, if they start to get really nasty and emotional about it, that just shows that they have something that's troubling them on the inside. They've got issues. If you respond in kind, it shows them that you have issues, right? In fact, Paul said in Colossians chapter 1, I believe it's verse 29, he said, in no way alarmed by your opponents, which is a sign of destruction for them, but of salvation for you, and that too from God. So don't be alarmed, you know. Listen to their stuff. Don't get frustrated. Don't expect to have all the answers, because you don't. I don't have all the answers. And be willing to say, that's a great question. Man, I don't know the answer to that, but I'll tell you what, I think I'd like to go and research that. How about I get back to you in a week and tell you some thoughts that I've developed on it since, and I'd be curious to see what, I mean, let's have an intelligent discussion on this. So have a really good discussion. You always hear, it's an adage, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And one thing I heard this morning about JoJo, about how he's dealing with a transgender person in a Starbucks and how he's been patiently and lovingly working with that person now for quite some time. And that's what you need to do with non-believers. Don't be alarmed. Don't get defensive. Learn your stuff. You know, get some arguments. You don't have to, you know, become expert in science and history and philosophy. Gosh, I would say to you, just master an argument for the resurrection of Jesus, because if you got the resurrection, you got God and Christianity, right?
Well, that's a great lead-in to our last question that I have on a card here. So if anyone wants to make their way to the mics at the front, feel free. The question is, what do you think is the most powerful piece of evidence you've found for Jesus' resurrection?
Okay. Well, there's quite a bit of evidence, but the most powerful piece I think I found is Paul. Because Paul was a non-believer before becoming a Christian, of course. He hated the Christian church. He hated Jesus. And he believed it was God's will to destroy the movement that Jesus had started. And then Paul had an experience that he was persuaded was the risen Jesus who appeared to him. And that radically transformed his life from being a persecutor of the church to one of its most able defenders. And by the way, this is what I just stated to you. We have eyewitness testimony from Paul himself in his undisputed letters, letters that even skeptical scholars say Paul wrote. And this is a fact that is granted by virtually 100% of scholars who study the subject, including Jewish, atheist, and agnostic scholars. So Paul was not a disciple of Jesus at the time of his conversion. He went from being a true enemy of Jesus to one of the most aggressive, proactive, effective leaders and propagators of the Christian church. Moreover, despite any hesitations one may have about the Gospels, we can establish Paul knew the Jerusalem apostles, had met with them, had run the gospel message past them that he had been preaching, and we can confirm historically, we have three different ways of doing this, and historians look for outside corroboration and all this, so we can put together three arguments to show that Paul was preaching the same gospel message as the Jerusalem apostles. So when we hear Paul in the resurrection, we are likewise hearing the voice of the Jerusalem apostles, that Jesus died, was buried, was raised, and that he appeared to both individuals and in group settings. And we get this from Paul. So even if we did not have the Gospels, we've got Paul, who claims to have been an eyewitness of the risen Jesus, who knew Jesus' disciples, got information with them. We can confirm he's preaching the same thing they're preaching. And we can also confirm from numerous sources that Paul suffered greatly for his faith and died as a Christian martyr, which attests to the sincerity of his faith. So Paul's pretty strong, and it's the thing that skeptics have the most trouble dealing with when it comes to the resurrection.